I guess we're going to start. Good afternoon, everybody. This is Andy Feng from Yahoo. In this talk, I'm going to try to show you what we are doing at Yahoo for the machine learning. Before I start, let me just give you my background. And I'm a system guy. I'm a newcomer to the machine learning, but I'm having lots of fun. And in my previous life at Yahoo, I have done lots of things like NoSQL database, like online advertisement, those things. And also I'm a committer of some of the Apache project. And in the last few months, I have been disappeared from the open source community because of this machine learning stuff. So in the talk, I will start with just make sure everybody understand where we're using for machine learning, and then talk about what's the challenge, what is the architecture choices we are making for the machine learning, and then we will talk about, you know, because I'm an architect, I better to talk of design patterns, and so that, you know, even hopefully the lesson we learned at Yahoo could be applied by the many others in your own machine learning, use case. And as you could, you know, that the Yahoo started, because we are, you know, we deal with lots of data, several years back, we started a project called Hadoop. And at that point, it was the main application use case, it was our search, advertisement stuff. Then later on, we made the Hadoop available as an open source at Apache. I think that helped the jumpstart the big data as the industry. And in the last year or so, we expand our big data infrastructure to including beyond technology beyond Hadoop. So we did the huge investment on the Storm. I will mention a few things later. And we also have been working with the open source community on Spark. And then recently, as I mentioned earlier on, we are getting into the machine learning, try to leverage the investment we have made over years and leverage the data we have gathered in our Hadoop clusters. As I mentioned in this slide here, we have lots of machines, and we have huge amount of storage in our things. And our mission here is to make those data become our asset. So we started the journey, about 2 years back from Yahoo homepage. Before that, our homepage was essentially static. Like we have a collection of very smart editors trying to assemble the page for our users. And in 2012, we said, you know, we have all those data, let's try a little bit for machine learning. So the top of that thing we called the Today module, that logically is supposed to be the popular articles that our users should read. As you could imagine, each of our users, you know, you could have a different thing you like to read, right? So as a result, what we decided doing here is every day we select like a few dozen popular articles. And for each of those articles, we build a machine learning model. Then when you come to our site, we will apply all those models, then select the best articles based on, you know, the match between you and our popular article. So that's what we got. This is the personalized Today module in 2012. As a result, we were quite anxious to see, you know, whether the machine learning thing going to make any difference or not. We were happy to saw the click-through result went up by a significant percentage. So that was our first taste of the success of machine learning at Yahoo. So then, the next year, we got a new CEO. And Melissa came in and said, you know, yeah, you guys did a good job for the today module. So what? That's so minimal, right? Why don't you change this whole page to based on machine learning? Now, step back. So she does not really, honestly, she did not give us a choice. She said, you do this editing in 45 days. So can you do it? We say, okay, we will think about it. Yeah. You tell me whether your team could do it or not. If not, I will have somebody else to do it. Okay, so we took on the Melissa's challenge. And what we're doing is beyond, if you open our homepage, the bottom portion is the streaming of the content and stuff. It's a lot of, you could keep scrolling, it's going to keep come back to the article to you. So if you think about it technically, we could not apply the previous approach for the today module because you have too many articles. You could not afford to build one model for each article anymore, right? So what we decided to do here is we build a single model for all the content. So we did that. Then after that, Melissa decided, you know, if we did a good job for the content, why don't you give me some revenue? So at that point, so we say inside that stream of the content, now we started to insert the ads, what we call the native ads in it. Right? So all those things is done by machine learning. And we have happy to report the team still continue doing their work. Melissa is very happy with the team. So, you know, that was the job we have done for the 45 days and ever since then. Then because of that, we expanded our machine learning things to every other areas, including our mobile side, right? You could imagine the machine learning thing, you know, even much more important in the mobile than your home, like in your desktop, because your space is so limited, right? So anyway, so those are the early success stories of the machine learning. Then you could imagine, like in many other places, like our search, our search result page here, for example, and the organic result of the search and the ads associated with the page, all of them are based on machine learning. Okay, so those are kind of the traditional stuff, right? Since everybody here is talking about the deep learning, let me share our story of our deep learning. So, early on, I mentioned the challenge from Melissa of our homepage. Then, almost the same time, Melissa also gave the challenge to our Flickr team. Before that, we have a limit of the number of the photos you could upload to our Flickr service. Then Melissa said, you know, storage is cheap. Why don't you just open it up? So we said, okay, we cannot really open it up. Melissa said, how about 1 terabyte for each user for free? So we did that. So as a result, you see this, a lot of people keep uploading your pictures with your digital camera or with your smartphones. Lot of pictures. Then we started getting user feedback. You put all my pictures there, but I could not find my picture anymore. Can you help? We said, you know, why don't you put nice tag over there, you know? We give you the way to put a tag. That's what you do, you know? What tag that we search for you? So at the 2013, right, you put a tag, let's say this one was a hummingbird. You do the search on the one side, you see that was this kind of thing you find, right? So that's not, then, you know, the user say, nah, you know, I'm lazy, you know? You guys figure out, right? So that's not the question. So Melissa basically said, no, you guys are smart, right? You guys figured out. So that's what we did. So here is logically, see, look at this result here. This is from our deep learning. And then with that, without the user's input, we try to understand what's in your picture. Is it a bird? Is it a beach? Is it a cat? Is it a dog? Whatever you may have. So those are just a few examples about how Yahoo, we apply the machine learning, try to make our service better. And you could imagine many other places, right? You know, as the other speakers in the today's meeting has been talking about those, we do many of those things by machine learning. So overall, you could see, you know, logically, Yahoo, we have lots of data about the user, about the content, all those keep coming in. We really need all, we apply the machine learning, we try to understand what the user want, what is the source content are. So that's our mission. That is the challenge from our big boss. And then from technology point of view, we try to say, you know, what we can do better. So as a result, we basically, we have been thinking about what we're going to do. So so I'm a simple guy, so I'm saying, you know, we have two small challenges. One is the scale, one is the speed. From the scale point of view, logically, we wanted to do the training against a large number of the examples, the features, the models, algorithm models, things. Because we believe, you know, because of the variety of the service we have, and also the changing of the world, we just have to live up to those things. We cannot apply so much constraints to say, you know, here's the limitations of our machine learning approach, right? And then when you talk about machine learning algorithms, we need to have support both the batch learnings, we need to support incremental learnings, we need to support the real-time learning, all those different flavors. So that's the scale side. And from a speed side, you could imagine, you know, as a user, you could imagine, you know, here, before you come to the San Francisco, you may be interested in stuff about, you know, which hotel you're going to stay, all those things. Once you got here, you know, you do not care about those anymore. You may be more interested in, you know, other stuff, right? So your user's interest is keeping changing. And on the other hand, all the content stuff is keeping changing as well, right? So let's say you have the breaking news showing up in the content stream. We need to bring those up to your user really quick. So from that point of view, we need to have a machine learning, come up with the model really quickly, bring to our user. Then, if we just apply a naive approach for our machine learning, like, for example, I have a very complicated machine learning algorithm using my desktop, you know, my very fast desktop. I do the training. For many of Yahoo cases, that could take days to just train a model. Right? That's not going to work. So from our point of view, we need to be able to train a model within a minute, and ideally within a second. We wanted the model there up to date. So this source challenge, what we decided to do is say, you know, we have been, as a company, we have made so much investment on the big data side. We have so much data in our, what we call the Hadoop cluster, right? We have all those data about there, and we have tens of thousands of machines sitting over there. So we have, as I mentioned earlier on, we have all the technology we have been invested on, like Hadoop, Storm, Spark, those things. So what we decided to do is say, we will build a machine learning platform on top of those technology. Okay? So for the people who, actually many of people here understand what all the technology are. So one is the Hadoop. Actually, everybody know Hadoop, right? Hadoop is the very fast, very efficient batch processing paradigm. You know, we developed it, and now many community users are using. Then another one we love is this Storm thing. From our point of view, you know, in some way it's just the Hadoop for real time, right? So it has a very similar flavors from the system point of view, like, you know, Hadoop. It's really reliable, have a simple API, have scalable, fault-tolerant, all those stuff, all the nicer flavor in it. This has been, you know, ever since we launched it about 1 year ago, so adoption at Yahoo has been amazing. It surprised me, because I have always been a platform guy. traditionally, the problem was to ask people adopt my platform. For this one, was you needed to convince them, say, you know, you should not jump in this, you should use the other ones. And so that was the one of the technology we love quite well. Then the other side, we also love the Spark. As the talk in the previous sessions, Spark enable you to leverage the memory things and enable you to define different type of the applications that MapReduce traditionally could, such as like iterative processing, that is kind of thing, many of the machine learning library you wanted to use, right? So anyway, so that's the kind of thing we want to leverage. So then the question is, so what, right? So then what can you do with the once you go down this path? So let me just tell you two recent stories we have achieved at Yahoo. So here's my first one. So at Yahoo, one of our most important applications has using decision tree for, I don't know how many years, for 8 years, so or maybe longer. This is a library we love the best because it decision tree algorithm we have had is really highly accurate. So like we have been spending, you know, several years investment on it. It's dang good. See, on the other hand, the challenge was because it's a boosted decision tree, it's a very sequential learning process. In our case, for those boosted decision trees, we create thousands of trees. So you could imagine with large data sets, if you create thousands of decision trees, in that approach, it take quite a while. Okay. Now, as a result, we say, okay, this is perfect. This is the, you know, it's the most important business case. The pain is there. So we decided to jump on this one first. So as a result, within 2-3 months, we basically achieved the 30x in speed up in terms of the training latency, right? So until then, it was taking several days of training. Now we basically, you know, 1 hour, 2 hours kind of things. And also on top of that, we actually made the accuracy improved as well. I'm not going to talk about too much details, but the concept of the idea is simple, right? For this, logically, you know, we have a huge data set. We partition the data sets by the features and bring them, source of the features are different map, Hadoop map. And on those map, we just running the training process. And during that training process, our map need to talk with one another. Then we leverage the MPI mechanism that's known in the industry. We just make it better and make it available on our Hadoop. So as a result, like you're just doing all those good job, as a result, then you, at the end, you just, okay, I'm done with my training. Here's my model, here you are. Simple, right? So that was our kind of first success. Then the second success was the story I was telling you about the neural network kind of things in our Flickr stuff, or what we call the auto tech. So what's going on here is, again, we leverage our big data infrastructures. So what we are doing here is think those are my training example as a picture, right? So what we do is in the Hadoop map, we run the neural network to extract the features. And from there, we have the feature extracted and then shuffle them to the reducer. For each reducer, logically we map the each different classifier to a different reducer, right? So you could, in this case I'm mentioning here, we have, you know, a few thousand classifiers. Logically, you know, you could imagine we have a few thousand reducer running over there. So all the pictures come in, all the features come in. Now we know. We pick the good scores for those classifier, we declare this is a summing bird, this is a cat, this is a dog, right? So this is kind of, you know, so you kind of leverage those things. As a result, we have like, we have the tens of billions of the picture by then. We finish this layer damn fast. So as a result, if you could, you know, just go out to go to your Flickr page to check out your own pictures to see whether we are doing the job or not. If you see any misclassified pictures, let us know. On the other hand, when you upload your pictures, we want to say, you know, when you upload the picture, we really want, you know, many users, when you upload that picture, we want to enable you to search your picture right away, right? And even you have not typed the things yet, type your tag yet. So again, here what we are doing is, say, you know, you upload your things, we put it into our image stores. At that point, we leverage our storm, we run using our storm doing performs the real-time machine learning. We're doing the scoring at that time because we have a classifier, right? We have the model over there. And then if you give us a feedback, say, you know, you said this is a cat. It's not a cat, it's a small dog. Then we will leverage that information to adjust our models. So this is the kind of example to leverage the storm source sense to do the real-time machine learning. So in nutshell, with our investment, now we are supporting a wide range of our applications to do machine learning. So here's my personal quick, you know, classifications about what kind of the ways how our different applications are using our platform. So one is those applications, there's various applications who want to do the machine learning in a batch. So I assume many of you do. So I'll show you how to do the trick, even without my code, okay. And then the second is saying, you know, you do the real-time things. Then the other is like, you may want to combine the real-time and the batch together, right? So for the batch, there's different flavors. One is you just wanted to run in the reducers that I was doing in our Hadoop, like a classifier at some portion of the thing, right? So what you needed to do, this is your design patterns, right? You needed to, logically, you needed to train a large number of the, you know, models. And on the one hand, for each model training, the data set is small. In that case, you could just leverage the Hadoop streaming. So inside the Hadoop streaming, the example showing over there, I'm just running a VW, you know, a legacy machine learning library over there, okay? Then on the other hand, then if you want to do more fancy stuff, like do the Hadoop machine learning in the map and need to do other things, in some time, I think you could do those. And again, you could leverage streaming things, but in those cases, likely you needed to have your library be able to understand how to communicate with other mappers. Then certainly I will encourage you to look into the Spark. And for example, one of our team in Taiwan, they wrote a certain line of the code, said it was their collaborative filtering for their e-commerce. That's simple, right? Everybody could do that. And on the other hand, the good news I think shared by the previous talk section, you know, there are the things like the Spark ML lab, something you could leverage. And I would also encourage you to look beyond ML lab. There's other machine learning library on the Spark, such as like the one mentioned over there. And then certainly on the other hand, you know, if you're thinking slightly deeper along the machine learning Spark source things, you may find sometime, you know, the Spark may not listen to the best, or the design philosophy behind the Spark or Hadoop source may not need to be able to handle the certain scenarios. For example, like we have been running a few hundred machines for machine learning for a few hours. This is at the last end, you want to combine them together, some of the machine failed or hanging. What do you do? Currently, the thing you needed to do is stop the whole job then start from scratch. I think that's not, from a machine learning point of view, that does not make sense to us. And we said, you know, from the, you know, you just, you know, throw away at 1% of data was the problem. So you couldn't go there. So for that purpose, we are working with the open source community. I think we are about to release our patch to this bug called partial reduce. That logic enable you to tolerate the failures of the system. Okay. Anyway, so then the real time, as I mentioned early on, you could do the storm sense. And then you could do the hybrid, bring the storm all the other things together. And then if you want to go fancier, and we are, at this point, we have developed this thing called parameter servers. And then that enable us to bring batch learning, incremental learning, real-time learning, serving system, all them together. And by the put all large models in this in-memory data store called the parameter server. So that's the all story, and that enable us to deal with many more models and enable different type of algorithms such as asynchronous learning. And then, so anyway, so that's our story. We are building the machine learning platform on top of our investment we have made so far on big data, and we are having fun with it. And we are having fun by working with our open source communities. That's why we have been, we continued to do our good investment on the open source. We'll be happy to, you know, help you to fix our open source code. And then if you want to help us, please join us. Our journey just started. Thank you.